1935, Hong Kong, which was a British colony at the time, was approaching 1 million in population. A variety of ships filled the deep protected waters of Victoria Harbor. On land, buses, trams, trains, and rickshaws carried people to and fro. In about a year, the first commercial airline would touch down in Hong Kong. Among the hustle and bustle of the streets were courts, hotels, post offices, shops, city hall complexes, museums, libraries, and of course some drugstores. In one such store, a man named Gustav Heinrich Ralph von Koenigswald was on the hunt for something very special. Despite being a drugstore, Ralph was not looking for any cure or remedy. He was searching for fossils. A paleontologist and geologist, Ralph had been obsessed with fossils from a young age and started his collection when he was just 15 years old when he got his hands on a rhinoceros molar. Browsing through the store of traditional remedies, Ralph was about to find something incredible. Ralph's curiosity was grabbed when he noticed items labeled dragon bones. The bones weren't reptilian though, they were from an ape. In fact, the molar tooth was somewhat similar to a human's, but it was significantly bigger. What kind of a giant left behind a tooth this big? Ralph decided to give the owner of this giant tooth the name Gigantopithecus Blackie. Gigantopithecus meaning giant ape, and Blackie in honor of Canadian paleoanthropologist Davidson Black, who studied human evolution in China and had died the previous year. Ralph realized there had to be more teeth, so he spent the next 4 years checking similar stores for these dragon bones, and whenever he found them, he purchased them before they could be used in some traditional medicine. Upon collecting more samples and doing some investigations, he realized that the teeth could have been from Guangdong or Guangxi. Unfortunately for him, his work on Gigantopithecus and other finds would be halted. During the Second World War, Ralph was in Java studying specimens that would eventually be recognized as Homo erectus when the Japanese army invaded. Before being sent to an internment camp, Ralph did his best to hide his fossils, and apparently he did a pretty good job as only one was found and confiscated. Supposedly the fossil was presented to the emperor. Because of this setback, further research on Gigantopithecus wouldn't progress until the 50s. While Ralph was imprisoned, other scientists attempted to classify this large ape. Robert Broom, a paleontologist from South Africa, thought that it might have been closely related to Australopithecus, and that it might have been the last common ancestor of humans and other apes. The anthropologist Franz Weidenreich thought that it should actually be called Giganthropus, meaning giant man instead of giant ape. He believed that at some point, our ancestors had gone through a gigantic phase. By the way, maybe we should talk about how gigantic this giant was. The first time I heard about this ape was actually from a friend who told me they had seen a documentary about an ape that was discovered that would have been as large as King Kong. And to be fair to the friend, articles online will often describe Gigantopithecus as a real King Kong, but it wasn't quite that gigantic. Different papers give different heights, but the estimated range of a standing Gigantopithecus was probably between 2.7 to 3.7 meters, so about 9 to 12 feet, and a study done in 2017 estimated a body mass of 200 to 300 kilos, 440 to 660 pounds. I should probably mention that from examining mandibles and upper canines from suspected male and female specimens, it would seem that there is a degree of sexual dimorphism, in that males are bigger than females. We see this in many modern-day apes, like gorillas. Returning to the early 50s though, in 1952, Ralph agreed with the consensus at the time that the ape was hominin, but he thought it was more of an offshoot rather than a human ancestor. The debate on how we should classify this large ape continued on until the mid-80s, when the Out of Africa hypothesis began to take hold. Now, the Out of Africa hypothesis, or at least a version of it, had been floating around for a while, but it gained more traction in the mid-80s when paleoanthropologists like Günter Brauer from Germany and Chris Stringer from the UK began to indicate that the earliest fossils that resemble members of our species came from southern and eastern Africa. While there are some disagreements over the timing and the routes of dispersal used by early humans, DNA comparisons and fossils strongly support that Africa was the source of modern-day humans. So where should we put our big cousin on the family tree? Well, in modern times, we would put Gigantopithecus in the subfamily Pongonae, and its closest living relative would be orangutans. A paper published in November 2019 for Nature examined the enamel on a Gigantopithecus molar and found that it was indeed related to orangutans. But if orangutans are still around, for now at least, why aren't their gigantic cousins still alive too? Well, while being big does have some advantages, for one thing you'd be more intimidating to a predator, it also has some pretty notable disadvantages. Gigantopithecus would probably have needed to eat a lot of food, not just because it was big, but also because it most likely had a higher metabolic rate, being warm-blooded. This ape seemed to prefer feasting on fruits and leaves, which was fine until it got to the period of the Pleistocene when these food sources started to become more scarce. The forested areas Giganto lived in started to turn into savanna landscapes. But that's not the only issue. In an interview for National Geographic, computer scientist Aaron Closet examined another problem with being big. He has studied the body sizes of thousands of species. When talking about size, he said, "It's not just that a bigger body requires more food. As you get bigger, you tend to have fewer children. That means your population tends to be smaller and more sensitive to fluctuations. These factors combined could explain why Gigantopithecus went extinct 300,000 to 100,000 years ago. Unless." Now, I wasn't sure if I should talk about this, as it might be a bit controversial, but since it has been brought up by people like David Attenborough in his Natural History Museum live show, and there's even a section about it on the Gigantopithecus Wikipedia page, let's take a look at the idea that Gigantopithecus is alive as Bigfoot. Now, this video isn't about whether or not Bigfoot is real. I merely want to explore the hypothetical that if such a creature does exist, could it be a modern-day Gigantopithecus? It seems that one of the earlier adopters of this theory was a zoologist by the name of Vladimir Chernesky. Now, if that name sounds familiar to you, it might be because he's the guy who dated the megalodon teeth from the HMS Challenger and got teeth that were 11,000 years old. Though we now know those dates aren't accurate. But regardless, in a 1951 issue of Nature, photographs were published on something that would become known as the Shipton Prints. The photos were taken by Eric Shipton. Some would say these were Yeti prints, and Mr. Chernesky believed that this was a Yeti, and that the Yeti was a descendant of Gigantopithecus. This was a popular theory in cryptozoology at the time. Ivan T. Sanderson, who was a zoologist and considered to be one of the founding fathers of cryptozoology, also spoke about the idea in his book, Abominable Snowmen: Legend Comes to Life. He also speculated that descendants of Gigantopithecus may have crossed the Bering Land Bridge into North America and might be the creatures behind Sasquatch or Bigfoot. So let's examine this. Again, I'm not trying to say whether or not Bigfoot exists. Just if it does exist, could it be Giganto? Well, Gigantopithecus certainly was big, and while Sasquatch and Yeti accounts might vary, they generally seem to be big animals, standing multiple feet taller than a human. But this also leads into our first issue, standing tall. It seems to be the norm that Yeti, Sasquatch, or Yeren are all bipeds, walking upright. Now, we don't have a complete skeleton of Gigantopithecus. We really only have jaw bones and teeth, so there is some speculation and guesswork. But since we know it was related to the great apes, particularly orangutans, it's generally thought that it was a quadruped, walking on all fours most of the time. Though it probably could stand on two legs and walk for a short distance like that. But images of Gigantopithecus standing on two legs are more about emphasizing its impressive size rather than suggesting it was a biped, a bit like how they do bear displays. Now, some have disputed this. The anthropologist and cryptozoologist Grover Krantz thought that Gigantopithecus was bipedal, as he noted the jaws widened towards the back, and proposed this was to allow space for the trachea when the skull is placed directly on top, closer to a human than other apes. The problem, though, is that many animals have jaws that widen towards the rear, regardless of being biped or quadruped. There's also the point that Gigantopithecus was very specialized in what it ate, unlike the supposed varied diet of a Bigfoot. It also sounds like from reports that if Bigfoot and the like do exist, that they are more closely related to humans. It would seem that in modern cryptozoology, less people think that these cryptids could be Gigantopithecus. Regardless of whether or not those cryptids exist, I do think that Gigantopithecus blackie is well and truly extinct. Funny how so far we only have the species G. blackie in the genus Gigantopithecus, but I guess some ape fossils are just hard to come by. But who knows, maybe a tiny piece of another giant is lying in an unlikely place, just waiting to be discovered. Thanks for watching.